keep you is our prayer. Grace, peace be unto you through Christ Jesus our Lord, who is also our Savior. To this eminent pastor, preacher, man of God, friend of mankind, brother beloved, Pastor Benford, who is, as I shared on last year, who has opened his heart and his ministry to allow me to come and share. I'm eternally grateful to him for this opportunity. It's not taken lightly. I've been in prayer and looking forward to coming and seeing you. Once again, to all of these pastors and preachers, to the Sage, Pastor Lewis, and brothers Russell and Hubbard, to those who are in the audience as well, it's really good to be in Albuquerque, New Mexico. One more time, and I bless the Lord. Thank him for all that he has done. I'm not one much for a lot of talking, so I just say, let's get to the word, all right? Thank you again, Pastor Benford, for your kindness and surely your support and your prayers. There is a word for us tonight found in 1 Kings chapter 18. To the deacons of this church and all of the fine members, it's good to see some of your faces again. It's good to know that the Lord has been good and kind to you even since last year. God be praised. 1 Kings chapter 18, there's a familiar story over there that we want to try to look at tonight and seek to hear what God has to say to the church. 1 Kings 18, verse 30 is where we want to start. It's probably where the gist of the message is. It simply says, and Elijah said unto all the people, come near unto me. And all of the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto him, unto whom he, the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And with the stones he built an altar the name of the Lord. And he made a trench about the altar as great as wood contained 2 measures of seed. But I really want to try to hang our hat tonight on verse 30. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. And that's what I'm going to talk about on this first night of revival, is repairing broken altars.
All right.
Repairing broken altars. It was during the time of the godless reign of King Ahab and his evil wife Jezebel. Ahab was king of Israel, and his Sidonian wife Jezebel was at his side. They ruled their constituents with an anti-God view. In fact, the Bible tells us that Ahab did more evil in the sight of the Lord than any king that was before him. He did more to provoke the anger of the Lord than all the kings put together. Right alongside him was his wife Jezebel, who herself was the daughter of a Sidonian king. She educated Israel in idolatrous practices. She took what she had learned over in Sidonia and brought it to God's people. She's the one that introduced them to the worship of Baalism, worship of the sun god, and other gods. She fed, remember, she's the one who fed and maintained 400 priests of an idol god, and it was all done at her expense. While her husband did the same with 450 priests. Seemingly out of nowhere, Elijah, a appears on the scene. Well, are you with me today?
Out of nowhere, Elijah appears on the scene.
He had been given the assignment by God, if you remember, to go and tell King Ahab. Remember in chapter 17, go tell Ahab that for the next few years, 3 years, there won't be any rain in the land. No rain. In fact, it's not going to rain until Elijah says, I speak the word. Elijah was to go and tell them that there won't be any rain. And tell them that all their crops are going to dry up. Tell them all of their water is going to be depleted. Tell them there won't be any fruit on their vines because there will be no water in the land. Tell them all of their cattle are going to die because of the lack of water. Go tell King Ahab that it's going to not rain in the land for 3 years. No rain for 3 years in the land. So God gave Elijah the message to deliver to King Ahab. God told him to leave and go. After he tell him to go and hide it. Because he's going to want to deal with you a little bit differently. After you tell him, after you deliver the message, go and hide it. And when you get over there, I'll take care of it. If I had time tonight, I would tell you, when God sends you on a message, when God sends you on a mission, you don't have to worry about what to say. You don't have to worry about what folks will say to you. Because God has a hiding place. And he can protect you when you do what is right. He says, go on and tell them what I told you to tell them. Where you're going to go and hide is by a little brook. You Bible readers know, down by the book of Cherith. And that's where you will drink from the waters of the flowing stream. You're going to be fed every morning and every evening. The ravens are going to provide you a Meals on Wheels program. You don't have to worry about where your food is going to come from. Just do what I told you to do, and I will take care of you. Steve says, but there's also going to be a day when the brook will dry up. God help me in this place. And then I'm going to send you to Zarephath. Over there is the city in Sidon, and not far from where Jezebel herself grew up. I'll touch a widow woman who's there with her son. I'll touch her to feed you, even if she has to feed you before she feeds herself. How many of you know God will take care of you? God will handle the rough stuff for you. God will take care of us. That's why you don't have to be afraid. She might just have a little bit of flour and a little bit of oil. But she's going to give it to you to give you the strength to go on a little further. Now, even as you go, I need to tell you, Elijah, Ahab is not going to let up off of you. He's going to continue to follow you everywhere you go. Of course, Elijah did, as I'm just giving you some background to get to where we need to go tonight. Elijah did as the Lord instructed him. God brought him through. That was in chapter 17. Are y'all with me? But here we are in chapter 18. And the Lord gives him another assignment. He tells him, now I know that you know that Ahab is trying to find you. I want you to do something strange that you haven't done before. Ahab wants to find you. Here is your assignment, Elijah. I want you to go to where Ahab is. Don't worry about what's going to happen again. I've been taking care of you all of this time. Go and make an appearance.
Obadiah, who was in charge of the king's palace. Obadiah, he told him, go throughout the land and find water because they were in the midst of a drought. And so it was his job to go through every nook and cranny to try and find water for Ahab and his army. Well, one day, he ran across Elijah. While he's looking for water, he ran across the man of God. He had contempt in his heart. He looked for the man of God, and he began to offer up some suggestions. Elijah began to talk to him. Obadiah recognizes who Elijah is. Elijah, as the Bible says in verse 7, falls on his face. Look at what he says to Elijah. Are you the one? That my king has been looking for. Elijah, are you the one? Elijah told him to go and tell his master that I want to talk with him. I want to spend some time with Ahab. Because I got a message I need to deliver to him before I get in trouble with the Lord. Tell him that God told me that we need to set an appointment and have a counseling session. Have I got a witness? So Obadiah makes his way to Ahab. Tell him this amazing news. And wouldn't you know it, they finally meet. Look at the first question that Ahab asked Elijah. He says, listen, are you the one that's been troubling Israel? Are you the one that's been causing all of this commotion? Because of you, we don't have any water. Because of you, the cattle is gone. Because of you, everybody's in an uproar. Are you the one? Help me today. Elijah says, listen, I need to answer you, King, because I know that you already know better, but I'm going to answer you anyway. He turned to him and said, no, it ain't me that's troubling Israel. As a matter of fact, you're the one. You're the one. If there's any trouble going on in the land, it's because of you. It's the consequences of your disregard for God's command. It's the consequences for you being disobedient to the, don't try to blame it on me. It's your fault that this land is in the state that it's in because you've been unrighteous and unruly. That Ahab, I want you to know that a lot of Israel is starting, Lord help today, to listen and be involved with this God of yours. I've been wanting to talk to you anyhow about this God you say can do all of these things. I've been wanting to have a face-to-face confrontation with you because you've been going the wrong way. You have been diametrically opposed to what God has said. And folks in Israel are starting to listen to the noise. They're starting to listen to you. They're starting to start showing up over at that church where Baal is God. They're starting to come away from the church of Israel and go to the church of Baal. And so I've been wanting to talk to you about that. I think it's time that we get this matter under control. I think it's time that we handle this once and for all. I think it's time that I'll tell you what I want you to do, Ahab. You're supposed to be this mighty man. You and your wife are supposed to have 450 prophets of Baal waiting at your command. well.
This Bible story, but when it comes time to
God.
Amen.
Elijah notices that Baal and all those folk are met with silence.
Yes.
No one, the Bible says a word. Nobody said, I want to be on the Lord's team. Nobody said, I want to switch. Nobody said a word. They were committed to their own gods and their own way. So Elijah makes them an offer that they cannot refuse. He proposes a contest between the God of Israel and the God of Baal. It's right there in verse 25. Baal is there, and Elijah is there. Elijah told the prophets of Baal, go ahead and prepare your altar. Choose one of the bulls for yourself. Don't let me do it, because you'll be talking about I did something under the table. You choose the bull that you want to place on the altar as a sacrifice to your God. Don't play around with it. After you get the bull ready, don't put any fire under it. Just call on your God. Don't light no matches. Don't do anything strange. If your God is who you say he is, he will have enough fire to send down and consume your sacrifice. Cigarette knife, you don't need none of that. Just put it on the altar. We'll wait for your God to come down. He's supposed to be the God of the sun anyhow. So he's used to hot stuff. He's used to fire. He's used to being a blaze. So it really shouldn't make him any difference. All we hear is a word, and he should be able to send down fire. Elijah says, go ahead. I'm going to let y'all go first. Get it all ready. Do what you got to do. Call on him to send down fire from the altar. The Bible says they invoked the name of Baal from morning to night. They cried out, Baal, answer us. Baal, if we ever needed you before, we sure enough need you right now. But the more they cried out, the less they heard. Still, there was no sound. So they had to up the level a little bit. They started now jumping around and doing all the kind of strange incantations, trying to get Baal's attention. Now Elijah is making fun of him. As he should. Now Elijah said, listen, you've been calling on your God for a long time. Maybe you ought to yell a little louder. After all, he's supposed to be your God. Maybe he's somewhere deep in thought. Or perhaps he stepped out for a moment. Or maybe he's taking a trip and it didn't leave you any forwarding address. Perhaps he's sleepy and he needs his rest and he can't hear you in his sleep. Just call him a little louder. Maybe he didn't turn on his cell phone. Maybe he didn't have his beeper ready so that when you called him, he would answer. Problem is, but keep on calling on your God. And maybe your God is out of the office. And he ain't in a moment's notice. I don't know, but whatever it is, it ain't worth it that you're doing. Keep on calling on your God. You have to understand at this time, those folk wanted to kill Elijah. They wanted to kill, they would have, but it would have only proved Elijah's point. That their God was not real. Then finally Elijah says to them, which is what the crunch of our text is tonight. Elijah says to them, finally, get out of the way.
this. If Baal ain't coming, shut it down. Listen, just shut it down. And he says, as a matter of fact, now that you've had your turn.
Yeah.
Now watch the work of the living God. Tell him to put it on the altar.
Yeah.
Put our sacrifice on the altar.
Yeah.
But I want to add something else to it.
Yeah.
I want you to drench it in water.
Yeah.
I don't just want you to put him on dry like yours was. I want you to drench him in water to where it comes up to the side and fills the rims. To drench our sacrifice in water and see if my God does not answer.